Our first word is goer, goer. Now, this is taking a word like go and just putting on the end of it, like teach and teacher or play and player. Now, a goer, we usually use this and we add this to the end of some other thing like a party goer, or in the case of the conversation, you'll hear a church goer. So someone who goes to church, someone who goes to parties, or again, this is just a more casual conversational way of talking about a person who goes to a particular thing. So if you don't want to say like teacher or player, like we don't really have those words specifically for going to a particular event, but we do say goer. So I am a concert goer. So I'm a person who goes to concerts. Next, y'all. Y'all. Now, this isn't really something you should learn and use yourself unless you're living in the southern part of the United States and really want to sound like a local. But this is something actually I use. I say y'all, and I have maybe just a very relaxed way of speaking, especially when I'm communicating conversationally with friends and family. But it just means you all. So it's talking about everyone. So instead of saying you, and we can use you as for one person, or we can talk about a group of people. So, I want to go with you to the party, meaning I want to go with, I want to go with this group of people to a party. But I can also say you all. I want to go with you all to the party. So it's the same thing saying you or you all, but you will hear this, and that's why I'm teaching it to you. Y'all. Y'all. Next, just very quickly, you'll hear a little bit about a southern accent. Now, this is talking about the southern part of the eastern United States. The west is a little bit different, but usually from maybe the top of Florida over across the southern states, like up to North Carolina. It's kind of like the southeastern fourth of the United States. So Florida doesn't really have this. Some people do speak that way, but really it's more of this kind of middle area above Florida along the coast. And these are called the southern states. So again, the southern part of the United States, this is talking more about from the United States history, where we have the Civil War with the North versus the South, and the United States really wasn't like an entire country at that point. So we had, or at least it didn't go all the way to the Western United States. So we didn't have a line that goes all the way across. It's really more just talking about the local bottom area, like over to Texas, that part. So that area where people are talking about having a southern accent, you'll just hear how Kate is speaking in the conversation. You can hear how she sounds. So she's going to give you some great examples of southern accent, and you'll hear us kind of joking about that in the conversation as well. So when you hear people talking about a southern accent, that's the area in the United States where we're talking about. So it's not talking about someone maybe from Texas. That's almost a particular kind of accent by itself, or even the Western United States. So there are different places you'll hear different accents or different dialects, but these are just different ways of pronouncing the same things. Occasionally you will hear different words for particular things, like you might say soda in one part of the country or pop for another. So this is for a drink like Pepsi or Coca-Cola. Next, this is an interesting word that appears as part of a phrase, and it's a commonly heard thing in conversations, especially when it seems like you're speaking to an audience like we are in the conversation. So the conversation Kate and I are having just between the two of us, we're also speaking to you. So you can hear the kind of way we speak and also listen to the words when we're describing something to everyone in the audience. So she'll say something like, the thing about it is people, and that people on the end is talking about the audience. So you'll hear that sometimes. I believe in a previous lesson set, I was talking about like all the people or to the people out there in some particular area. So this is a way that maybe television stations or programs or radio would also do the same thing, where they're speaking out to a particular audience. So if you hear people, so a sentence like coming from the conversation, well, the thing about it is people, I'm talking to you, so I'm explaining to you something, but there's nothing about having people in that situation or in that sentence that has anything to do with the sentence itself. It's just addressing the audience. Next, a great word, designate. Designate. This is a more advanced word, but you will hear it very often, especially in situations where we want one person specifically or one group of people to do something. So to designate just means to make someone responsible or some group responsible. A very common example is the designated driver, also known as a DD in casual conversations. So a designated driver is someone, maybe you're going to a group or it's a group of people going to a bar and going drinking. One person does not drink because they are the one who will be driving. So this is the designated driver. So when you designate someone, it just means you're giving that person responsibility for something. Designate. Designate. Next, amused. Amused. Amused is when you find something pretty funny. You can say something is very amusing. So something it could be funny or amusing or really funny or hilarious. Wow, that was really hilarious. So you're laughing at something, but amusing is kind of in the middle. So it's funny, and it also can mean not just funny, but it can mean interesting. So you're not laughing at something, but you can say, I find it amusing that my friend doesn't want me to do something, but he does it himself. So I'm just saying, I find it interesting. I'm kind of smiling about that. So I might not be laughing about it. Again, amusing is kind of in the middle, or like kind of a lower level of maybe just kind of smiling or thinking something is a little bit funny or interesting. Amusing. Amusing. Next, you'll hear a word that's actually incorrectly used in the conversation, and I wanted to make sure you understand it, and this is the word indentation, indentation. Now, an indentation, like if I have this board behind me and I punch it, it leaves a mark or an actual impression in the board itself. So that creates an indentation, or we just call that also a dent. But Kate was actually using this word incorrectly, calling it an indention, indention, when she's talking about the little spaces or the little holes inside of a part of the guitar. Now, this happens sometimes in conversations, and there's nothing bad that she said that. We all do this, or maybe it's the same thing when we're trying to sing a song and we say the words incorrectly. But most of the time in conversations, this is a mistake, well, where the native speakers you're speaking with, so maybe your friends or family or coworkers, they understand what you're saying. So you don't really have to worry about that. And this is one of those lesser mistakes. So it's not very important. It's okay if you make a mistake like this. This is much better than actually making a very large, big error with basic grammar or something like that. So I just wanted to make sure you understand that so you hear it when it comes up in the conversation. So not indention, but indentation. Indentation. Next, a really fun word that hopefully you start using. This is to crash something, to crash a party. Now, listen for this in the conversation, but just crashing something means to go into something uninvited. So you can think about like crashing a car through a wall and then you appear and say, hey, it's me, I'm here at the party. So this is kind of a typical thing people talk about when they talk about crashing a wedding. There's even a movie called The Wedding Crashers where these two guys, they just go to different weddings because it's a great place to meet women and drink for free and all these other things. So Wedding Crashers. It's actually a pretty funny movie. But again, this idea of just crashing something to crash a party, typically crash is used for talking about parties, but it just means going somewhere where you haven't been invited. Usually some kind of party. To crash something. Crash. Next, and everything. And everything. Now, this is used typically after a list of words or phrases where you're describing something and you have to say, well, I had to do this and that and everything, or and everything else. You can use both of those. But it's a very casual conversational way of describing this, where you have a list of things and you don't want to say all of them, but you want to imply or show that you're talking about many things that you have to do or that you had to do. So I had to study and take a test and practice and everything. So even if you didn't have any other things that you needed to do, it makes it sound like a lot more, usually because you're very busy and it's just a better way to describe that. And everything. And everything. Now listen carefully how this blends when you're saying it after the end of some kind of list, because it becomes more and everything. Like this and that and everything. And everything. It's more of just the n sound, but people understand you're saying and everything. And everything. I had to go here and there and buy this and everything. And everything. Next, ages ago. Ages ago. Now, ages ago just talks about a long time ago. When we talk about something like an age, we really mean maybe 100 years or 1,000 years, something like that. But often in conversations with natives, we kind of blow things up, we exaggerate, and this just means making something seem bigger or larger or more important than it actually is. So I might say, oh, I haven't been to that party, oh, in ages. So it just means, or I haven't done something in ages. Maybe that's 5 years or 10 years or something like that, but at least, you know, older than a few years. So you can say, I haven't done something in ages, or ages ago, where you're talking about some past time period. Ages ago. Ages ago. Next, fruitful. Fruitful. Now, if you just think about a lot of fruit, it's the same thing as saying a reward for something. So something was very fruitful. I had a very fruitful discussion with a friend of mine. It means it was valuable to me, rewarding to me. I benefited in some way from that thing. So if an exercise, like I'm doing some meeting or talk at work and it was very fruitful for the other people listening, then they got some kind of good information from that. It was very fruitful. Fruitful. And one final thing here, we've got theirs when we're talking about a plural collection of things. So typically in conversations, native speakers will try to shorten things as much as possible. We will say things like going to, but we will say it faster as gonna, or want to becomes wanna. And anytime we can shorten this, just like we're talking about, there is a chair over there. So there is one chair over there. We would shorten that to there's a chair over there. But often in conversations, because we can't shorten there are, it doesn't really work that way. There are, we don't have a contraction for this. We often use theirs, even though people understand what we say, but this is just a casual way of describing this. So we can say, there's two cats over there. There's two cats over there. Now, if you say it quickly, people will really think you're sounding native, even though you're actually speaking incorrectly. Isn't that funny? But this is a common way that we speak, and you'll hear this in the conversation. There's. There's. Now let's move on to the longer phrases and expressions from this month's conversation. The first one is, like I said, like I said. Now you'll hear just generally in the conversation things like, you know, and this is part way of giving yourself some time to think, but also just asking for a connection, making sure the other person is listening and understanding what you're saying, or even just empathizing with you. And again, that just means you're connecting with the other person, like you're complaining about something, like, yeah, I was really busy at work and we had these problems, you know. So I'm asking the other person, like, yeah, do you understand? Do you feel what I'm saying? But when people are talking about these things, often they are also just, you know, again, here I am saying, you know, right there. I put in, you know, in that example, just asking if you know what I'm saying. So it's part filler word, but also asking for clarification or kind of making a connection with the other person. But like I said is also a similar way. It's like a filler word or a filler phrase, but you're trying to return back to something you said previously. So if I'm describing something and then maybe I talk about something a little bit different and then I say, well, like I said, then I kind of come back to that first thing and explain that a little bit more. So I could be giving an example, or I'm giving a lecture and I explain something and maybe a person has a question and I say, well, like I said, we're going to do this. And I explain that same thing again, usually in some kind of simple way. Like I said, like I said. Next, one of the many great phrasal verbs that we will be covering in this lesson set, as well as you'll see in the conversation, this is to bleed through, to bleed through. Now, if you think about regular blood just coming through, you have a cut on your arm or your body somewhere and the blood is coming through. When we talk about something bleeding through, we also use this idea of kind of a thicker thing. It could be water or something like blood or oil or something like that. But usually it's coming through something like paper or some cloth or, you know, some other fabric, something like that. So something that bleeds through, this is the physical idea of I have something like maybe a piece of paper and then I have like some blood or something on this side and it slowly comes through, it bleeds through the paper so that it shows up on the other side. So I might have you know, some, again, it's a physical thing where I have like a liquid or something like that, and it comes through like on the top and it slowly bleeds through, and then you can see it on the bottom as well. But remember, with phrasal verbs, we begin with this figure, or we begin with the physical idea of something bleeding through, but we also can take that and then have the more figurative kind of a metaphor, an idea of something where we're not physically bleeding through anything, but the idea is the same. So you can talk about, like my patriotism bleeds through. So I'm like, maybe, you can really see that I care a lot about my country, or I sing the national anthem. So that's like my country's song a lot. But these things kind of bleed through. So maybe even talking about one generation to the next, where your parents do something and those ideas kind of bleed through to the next generations as well. So the same idea is passing something down from one generation to the next, but this is a really great way of talking about this, to bleed through, bleed through. Next, to whip something out, to whip something out. Now, if you think about a whip, this is like a long chain or string, and you crack it like Indiana Jones does, and he's got his whip and he's trying to swing from something like that. When you whip something out, it means you pull something out very quickly, just like a whip. So if I whip out my credit card, if I'm really excited, wow, I go to the store and see some new pair of shoes, and I really love to buy shoes, and I'm so excited, I don't just take out, which is another great phrasal verb, to take out my credit card. I whip out my credit card, to whip out. It's almost like a whip. It's a whip. So I whip out my credit card, or I whip out something. And again, this just means you're taking something out or moving it or showing it to people very quickly, to whip something out. Next, I'm not gonna touch that. So to touch something, I'm not gonna touch that. Now here again, we have that shortened going to becomes gonna. I'm not gonna touch that. I'm not gonna touch that. Now to touch something, again, we have this physical idea of touching something, and also the figurative idea about talking about something, or having something, some connection in some way to a particular thing. So I'm not going to touch something. Like a friend of mine, maybe he's having a political discussion, and it's getting, maybe people are starting to get very excited and very emotional. I say, I'm not going to touch that discussion. So I'm not going to touch that topic. It means I'm not going to speak about that or join that conversation, because I don't want any trouble. So I'm not going to touch that. Or if you have even some physical thing, like there's some like sharp thing on the ground, well, I'm not going to touch that. So that's a physical idea of not wanting to touch something. But again, the more figurative use that you'll hear in the conversation is, I'm not going to touch that thing. So again, like, I don't want to have a connection or to be involved in that in some way. Next, related to this, is I'm losing my touch. So to lose your touch, like he loses his touch or she loses her touch. Or you can also hear to lose your mojo. Now, mojo isn't in the conversation, but it basically means the same thing. Your mojo is like your life force, or your energy, or your skill with being able to do something. This was really popularized by Austin Powers in a movie quite a while ago, but I think he lost his mojo, and they took that as like a physical idea, like he lost his power with women and his creativity and all these other things, and he became very, very weak, and he lost all of his confidence when he lost his mojo. So he had to find his mojo again. But to lose your mojo with something just means you're losing a connection with something, like you don't have that anymore. So you've lost touch. You have that physical touch, but we're talking about the figurative idea of not being able to do something very well anymore. So I don't have the ability, like I don't play the guitar anymore. So I've lost my mojo. I've lost my touch with something. Next, another great phrasal verb, to move up to something better. So to move up, to move up. Again, we have the physical idea of going higher, moving to some higher location, but we also have the idea of graduating. So we're figuratively graduating from one thing to usually something better. So maybe a young child, if they're playing an instrument, they might begin even as a young baby with some kind of plastic instrument, like a plastic piano or a plastic trumpet or something, and then they move up to an actual real one. It might not be the best or the most high quality, but they're moving up to a particular thing. So you might move up to a higher level thing, just like you move up through, you know, your regular learning and education. So you move up from high school to college, or you move up through a company. We talk about people moving up through the ranks. So a rank is like your level, moving up through the ranks in a particular company or organization. Next, we've got the music capital of America, the music capital of America. Kate is talking about Nashville, Tennessee in the, Nashville, Tennessee, I believe, in the conversation. And when she's describing, Nashville, she's saying it's like the music capital of America. Now, there are obviously lots of different kinds of music in America. Hip hop and rhythm and blues are also called R&B, or we have jazz or classical music, lots of different kinds of music. But kind of the like older, maybe folk music or especially country music. This is really coming from the southern part of the United States and Nashville specifically. So it's like we can call that like the music capital of the United States. But this idea of like the X capital of Y, you can use that as anything if your local neighborhood or your town or your city is really famous or known for a particular thing, even if that's not maybe publicly, like people don't use that term, like the music capital of the United States is something that's, it's fairly well known as a phrase for talking about Nashville. But the United States, again, you can have that example for music, but you can do it with anything else. So I might say like Chicago is like the pizza capital of the United States, or this restaurant is, you know, whatever, or this area, typically it's like an area or something. This is like the, I don't know, like the furniture capital of, you know, this particular city, something like that. But you can, again, describe that thing when you're talking about this place is known for a certain thing. But if you want to say that more like a native speaker, you can talk about the capital of something else. So like Washington, D.C. is the actual capital of the United States, or Tokyo is the actual capital of Japan. You can talk about, again, like some local food or some music or something like that is the capital of a particular place. Next, another great phrase you can use in a conversation, whether you want to just give yourself a little bit of time to think or you actually want some help, you can say, correct me, or somebody correct me, because you'll see in the conversation, again, Kate and I are speaking, but we also have an audience watching us. So she says, somebody correct me, even though you can't really do anything, you're just watching the video. But that kind of idea of somebody correct me, or if you're speaking with somebody directly, you can say, correct me if I'm wrong. So correct me if I'm wrong, but, and then you go on to explain something. So correct me if I'm wrong, Nashville is in Tennessee. Now, maybe it's someplace else. I'm pretty sure Nashville is in Tennessee, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it's in someplace else. But anyway, you can use that as a way of maybe you're saying something, but you're not so confident about what it is. So you might, maybe you don't know the correct word for something in English, and you can say, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is called something. So the correct me if I'm wrong phrase actually makes you sound native. So if you just practice saying that and then you make a mistake or use a different or incorrect word after that, it's still okay. Correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. Next, another great phrasal verb, to switch around. Switch around. Now, switch around can mean two things that are replacing their positions in some physical thing. Like I have one chair here and one chair here, and I'm going to switch them. Like I have maybe one person sitting here and I want to have him switch with this other person, to switch them around. Or it could mean, can mean to have a group of things where you're switching them all around. So if I'm planning a wedding and I have all of these different tables at the wedding party after the wedding, I want to switch around the tables or switch around the people. So I'm moving lots of different things. But this is just a casual way of talking about either reversing something or moving or mixing something in a different way, to switch around. Next, you'd think that, and one would think. Now, this is an interesting way where we're describing something as a native speaker, but we find it interesting, or we're confused by it, we're puzzled by that thing. So I could say, well, like, one would think you shouldn't eat donuts for breakfast, but a lot of people do. So maybe I think it's like a bad thing for your health to eat donuts. You should have something healthier for breakfast. So one would think, so it just means one would think, this is another way of saying it's common sense, or hopefully most people understand that you should be doing something or not doing something. But I'm really just sharing my opinion and trying to make it stronger. So I'm trying to say, like, you shouldn't eat donuts for breakfast because maybe it's bad for your health. But I can say, to make it sound a bit more advanced and educated and more like a native speaker, I can say one would think you shouldn't eat donuts for breakfast. So one would think. So like if I see something like, why do they do that? That's really interesting. One would think you wouldn't want to do that. So I'm almost not saying it's my opinion. I'm kind of saying it's like the general opinion, but I'm giving it. So it's kind of a sneaky way of describing an opinion, but saying maybe a lot of people share this same opinion. So you might think, or one might think, that you should do a particular thing, or you should not do a particular thing. Next, another great phrasal verb, to get away with something, to get away with something. Now, listen as I blend this together, because this is how it sounds in any conversation. To get away, get away, get away. To get away with something, we have the get, and then we're moving away. Usually we're taking something, or just by ourselves, we are removing ourselves, or myself, from a particular scene. So like a person who's robbing a bank, I go to a bank and I say, give me your money, and I take all the money, and then I get away. So I'm trying to get away, me personally, with the money. So I'm getting away. Or if I tried to steal something, even if I maybe dropped that thing, I don't want to be caught by the police, so I run away. I'm trying to get away. We even have a getaway car. So getaway becomes a phrasal noun, to get away. We have a getaway car when someone is driving away, and that's the car we use. You know, after I rob the bank, I get in the getaway car so I can get away. So I can get away. But listen to the pronunciation again. Get away. The T becomes more of a D and it's blended together. Get away. Get away. When you get away with something, it's a form of cheating, or again, you're leaving something like that. So I might be able to get away with, and not in a really bad sense, like I'm cheating. But a friend of mine, if he says, hey, can you play in my band tonight, because a friend of mine can't join me, he can't play the guitar, he's sick or something. So I say, well, I can't really play the guitar, but maybe I can get away with playing just a few chords or something I know how to do. So if you play some simple music, I can probably help you. So in that sense, you're getting away with something, just meaning you're not really doing it exactly how it should be done or in the best way, but it's still doable. It's something that's possible, to get away with something. Next, to come by something. So to come by something means to obtain it, to possess it in some way. We don't really know how you come by something. Maybe someone gave it to you or you bought it. That's not really important, but the idea of coming by something means receiving that thing. So now you have it. But often you'll hear in conversations, as you'll hear in this conversation, that something is hard to come by, hard to come by. So it just means it's difficult to get some kind of thing. So it's hard to come by, maybe like a particular guitar, like a left-handed guitar that's very rare. So left-handed guitars are hard to come by in my area. They're hard to come by in my area. So anything where it's difficult to find that thing or get that thing somehow, it's hard to come by. Hard to come by. Next, some more great phrasal verbs, to let things go or to get rid of something. Now you hear let something go, and it can mean when you physically have something in your hand. This is the physical idea of you open your hand and it falls out, to let something go, let it go. Just like the song, let it go. You know, I think I've sung that song a couple of times or tried to sing it in these lessons. Anyway, I'm not the best singer, so I will let it go. I will let that ability go. So when you let something go, maybe you have to move from your house into a smaller house and you have lots of stuff you have to give to other people or to throw away, to remove that stuff because you can't bring it with you. Some things you have to let them go. So it just means you're holding on to something, physically holding it, but also emotionally, mentally holding on to that. So maybe you have some artwork that your young child drew when they were like a little kid, and now they are 20 years old and you don't know what to do. Should I throw away this art, or should I keep it, or something like that? So if you let it go, maybe you give it away, or you put it in the trash or something like that. So you can give something, like give something up in the same way. You can say, well, I don't need this object anymore, or this thing, so I'm going to let someone else have it or just put it in the trash. Next, another great phrasal verb, to mess around with something. Now, mess around, this just means where you're not really being serious about something, or you're experimenting, you're playing with it in some way. So I'm on the computer and I'm typing in some code, or I'm trying to just draw some pictures and think about, maybe get some ideas going. Maybe I want to make a game or some new kind of music or something. So I'm messing around. I'm just, you know, trying different keys or listening to different notes and trying to find something where maybe I don't have a good idea. I'm just messing around right now. But it also means just to play, like if you have a child and you want them to sit still, so don't move and try to focus on something. I say, hey, stop messing around and focus. So children are moving around and playing and doing lots of things, but they can't just sit still and listen. So sit down, sit still, and stop messing around. And finally, I'll be the first to say. I'll be the first to say. Now, this is another great phrase that you should remember as a phrase like this when you're admitting something or you want to show maybe something isn't really the best idea. So I might say, like, I built a company like this. So I did this thing and then that thing, and it was actually really complicated. I probably wouldn't recommend other people do that. So I'll begin explaining that by saying, I'll be the first to say that it's probably not a good idea. So it's kind of like you're admitting maybe it's not so good, or you're trying to show other people that they should be cautious about what you're saying. So I'll be the first to say that something like this. So I'll be the first to say it wasn't a good idea, or I'm admitting like maybe I did something wrong. So I was recommending that people do this, and I'll be the first to say it probably wasn't a good idea, but in the end it did work for some people. I'll be the first to say. So it just means I'll admit something. Well, that's it for this lesson. Hope you have enjoyed it. Remember, not just to watch it or listen to it one time, but try writing down these things actually with a pencil and paper or a pen and paper. Go back and actually listen. Take a few days with this lesson. Really practice it. Go back and review everything, and you really will start seeing this vocabulary appearing in your conversations. I look forward to seeing you in the Fluency Corner lesson coming up next. And until then, 1. Click on this link to subscribe to my YouTube channel for over 500 free videos. 2. Click on this link to download my number one ebook guide to fast fluency, free. And 3. Click here to watch the most popular video on English fluency here on YouTube.